This is Bill Newman, WHMP.
Welcome to NPR, Northampton Poetry Radio, with our erstwhile Poet Laureate, Rich Michelson.
Actually, Bill, it's erstwhile Poets Laureate today.
It's we like have attorneys general.
That's right. Yeah, we have my successor.
And Rich is Michelson.
Mr. Patrick Donnelly joins me today, who was also Northampton Poet Laureate right after I was. He fulfilled his term. And he is here fresh from a gig in Portland, Oregon at Associated Writers Program, where he sold out 75 copies. In one signing for poetry, this is big news.
I thought you meant he sold out.
Like, he sold out. Oh, no, that's,
he's only writing limericks now.
That's years ago. So one of the most anticipated books for me this year was Patrick's new book, Little Known Operas. I'm going to hold it up. Look at this cover. This is absolutely
gorgeous.
Look
at everybody.
So this is from Four Way Books, and we are having a launch party for Patrick's book is Friday, this coming Friday, April 5th, at Amherst Books. That's on Main Street in Amherst, Massachusetts. I hope everyone comes. This is the local launch, or the really launch before you head out to like 35 cities over the next...
A bunch of other places, yes. And there'll be food and drink and... lots of good people, and hopefully it should be fun.
Well, this
Amherst
is
Books
great.
Friday, what time?
Amherst Friday at
7 p.m.
Yeah. And while you have your calendars out, because you're all writing that down, let me also mention that Patrick will be reading Sunday, May 12th at 4 p.m. At Seeley Hall in Smith College for the Gallery of Readers series. So you have a couple of chances, but we're hoping to see you this Friday. It's going to be wonderful. This is an absolutely gorgeous and beautifully written book. I'm going to have you read, but I want to quote something first that Bill Newman's old college roommate said about this book, Mr. Gregory Orr.
A fabulous poet.
A fabulous poet.
But not about this book.
Oh, about your work
about
in general?
About my first book.
We'll quote it anyways because it goes double for this book. Everything he writes is suffused with tenderness and intelligence, lucidity and courage. Gregory Orr.
Well, he said everything he writes, so by extension, so this could also be right. For this book.
And yeah. Everything he will write.
In the future, all right. And Bill, you know that he speaks his mind, right?
Gregory or Patrick?
Gregory.
Yeah, both. Yeah,
I don't know how well you know Patrick, but Gregory, I know you lived with. So, Little Known Operas. Mm. This is a book that talks a lot about Maria Callas.
The great opera singer.
The great opera singer.
1923 to 1977.
And talks a lot about Jesus Christ.
About Jesus Christ. But my own very strange version of Jesus, who is a gardener, a Sufi, an esoteric Buddhist, an atheist, a sufferer of ocular migraines, and a fan of Federico Garcia Lorca.
Well, that's a different Jesus. That's a different
Jesus. I got to talk to my rabbi because that sounds pretty good.
Right. But Maria Callas is the Maria Callas we know.
Well,
and love.
Yes. And how does Callas get, how do you get from Jesus to Callas? Well, Jesus mentions her. As one does. And then the Callas sequence sort of spins off from the Jesus sequence and then turns around to argue with it. But yeah, he's interested in Callas.
The Jesus sequence you published in the chapbook, and I thought the poems were just wonderful. Let's give our audience a taste of what we're talking about. If you can, do you have a poem that might mention both?
Absolutely. This is the central poem in the book.
Okay.
It's where Jesus mentions Callas. Jesus said, "Just when I think I've heard everything Callas recorded, I stumble on something new. This Saint-Saëns thing, I almost didn't click on because it was, you know, Saint-Saëns, who stormed out of the Rite of Spring, 29 May 1913, infuriated over the misuse of the bassoon. Anyhow, 61, Paris, Callas with her musical friend Georges Prêtre. Too bad they couldn't have married as well. They were good together. It was 3 years after her voice was supposedly gone, she gave to one listener an experience he described on YouTube. Working with my dad in the chip shop, radio on in the background, this was played. I couldn't recognize the singer, but remember saying, "Dad, she has to be one of the greatest in the world." Her voice confused me. But how often do we get a chance to listen as if for the first time? His first time, so close to her last time. You, writing this, Jesus said, tried to be a singer when you were young. You weren't good enough. But Callas opened a neural pathway through which the representations run, masks of light and shade. Maybe her voice had almost to be gone before it could prove with inevitable little slidings from one note to its neighbor or wider, Delilah to Samson, that her confidence was shot but not her throat, still changing every note's color. All that has dark sounds, roots thrusting into the fertile loam known to all of us, ignored by all of us, a power and not a behavior, a struggle and not a concept, not even in the throat but surging up from the soles of the feet, her feet, before which lay paradise.
You're listening to NPR, Northampton Poetry Radio. My name is Rich Michelson. My guest today is Patrick Donnelly, and his new book, Little Known Operas. There will be a book launch party at Amherst Books, 7 p.m. in Amherst, this Friday, April 5th. Patrick, that was a beautiful poem.
Thank you.
So you were an opera singer before you were a poet, yes?
I tried. I went to Oberlin Conservatory. And I had grown up with the opera. My mother first took me to the opera when I was 6 years old. And I was in the children's chorus at the Santa Fe Opera, when I was about 10 years old. So I was smitten with that art form, and I tried to do it. I had a sort of nice, light lyric baritone mm-hmm. voice. But it's a really hard skill set to put together, and I did not do it.
So were you writing poetry the same? Did that come later? Where did the poetry come in?
I wrote as a kid. My mom also loved poetry, so you know, it was one of the coins of the realm in our house. If you wanted to impress your mom, you wrote a poem, or you tried to write a poem.
And was she a teacher?
She'd put it on the refrigerator. Say that
was
again.
Was she a teacher?
She was a teacher. Mm-hmm. She was an English teacher for most of her life. Yeah, and she read me Yeats and, Whitman and all her favorite poems. So that's how that started. And that I wrote always, but I tried to be several different things before I turned to writing.
Do you still sing?
I don't. You know, it's... Opera singing is like being an athlete. You mm-hmm. can't just get up and do it. You have to train every day for that. So I'm now the world's best consumer of good singing, you know, in every genre. I know how hard it is when I see people do it really well. And, you know, maybe that's being a good audience member. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's as good as being a performer.
Well, that's the Maria Callas part of the work. Let's talk about Jesus a
right.
little bit. Tell me a little bit about your religious.
Walk with the Lord.
because your poems do, I mean, mm-hmm. outside of, we're kind of joking a little bit about Jesus. But this book has a real serious exploration of religiousness, and it has that deep sense of spirituality throughout it. I mean, it's very moving in every way.
Thank you.
So
So I grew up in no religion. My parents were not religious. My mother was a very aggressive atheist. She thought that religion was the worst thing that ever happened to humanity.
We have that in common, actually.
Okay.
And there was this other guy. What was his name said about religion as the opiate of the masses?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Mr. Yeah. Marx, I believe.
Groucho?
My dad was sort of gently agnostic in that way that a lot of
So your dad was gently agnostic, but your mom was aggressively atheist.
Exactly.
Got it? Okay.
But neither
She'd
one
beat up the Jehovah's Witnesses when they come to the door.
But then, remember Jesus Christ Superstar? That happened. Mm-hmm. I got really into listening to that recording, and I just became spiritually curious, and my first stop was at the synagogue in Santa Fe, New Mexico, where I lived. And I didn't know this, but it's a Jewish tradition to send the seeker away when they first knock on the door. 3 days. 3 times. And I didn't know this, so I just went away.
You were cordially invited to leave.
Yeah. Also, my dad was a politician, and I'm sure the rabbi took one look at me and thought, I'm not touching this. So my next stop was the Roman Catholic Cathedral on the plaza in Santa Fe, and they did not send me away. And I studied.
Yeah, we lost another one.
Right.
Right, Bill.
Right. And so
we didn't make you have to draw blood.
A year later, I was in a Franciscan seminary in suburb of Detroit. And then 10 years later, I was studying Zen Buddhism in New York City.
Was this a comparative religion exploration for you personally? What you had in mind?
I just kept looking for something. I ended up with the Sufis in Southern Illinois for 4 years before 9/11. So I had this amazing experience of Islam before the crash happened. And so now I'm a synthesis of all these different things. And it's all love. It all comes down to love for me. I'm not interested in the legalisms. Mm-hmm. I'm interested in the devotion and the love and the creativity that springs out of that.
You're listening to NPR, Northampton Poetry Radio. My name is Rich Michelson, The Bill Newman Show. And my guest is Patrick Donnelly, who has a book launch party this Friday, April 5th, at Amherst Books. That's Main Street in Amherst, Massachusetts.
7 o'clock. And we're going to talk more with Patrick and with Rich right after this.
This is Bill Newman, WHMP. This is Bill Newman, WHMP.
And we continue NPR Northampton Poetry Radio with our Poets Laureate, Rich Michelson, and Patrick Donnelly.
And Patrick Donnelly, who is reading at Amherst Books, 7 p.m., Friday, April 5th. So you had, before this came out, I read the chapbook of a series of your Jesus poems. Mm. When you started writing one poem and then it just led to another poem, did you have something in mind to explore your own religious exploration?
No, this wasn't a project book. I did not set out to write 15 poems about Jesus. I just wrote one. And then I thought, well, what if I made him say other stuff, you know? And I also took poems that had not been about that or had not been in the voice of Jesus, and I made them.
Okay, so, from your voice to Jesus's voice.
Yeah, so right. What if I made him talk about
questions.
Maria Callas? Mm-hmm. You know, so that's where that came from, and the same with the Callas poems, you know, so that, you know, what if I spun off and confused Maria Callas with my own dramatically troubled mother? So no, it wasn't conceived. It just went there.
And when you had that idea to put them both in one poem, was it like an aha moment?
I was like, can I do this? You know, but yeah, it was.
Mm-hmm. You had to check your poetic license.
That's right.
Is this allowed?
I had to look at the small print. Right. Yes.
And you also translate with your husband, Stephen Miller, Japanese, from the Japanese poems. And you spent a lot of time in Japan. Again, did you go to Japan first as part of kind of a religious pilgrimage or learning, or where did that come into your life?
No. Before I met Stephen, I only knew about Japan what everyone knows. He opened that whole world to me of Japanese literature and culture. And he lived in Japan for 9 years. I've been there now 4 times for a total of maybe 6 months. And I absolutely love it. It's wonderful to have something that brilliant sort of break into your life late in your life.
Was Stephen translating Japanese poetry before he met you?
Yes, very much so. So his scholarly focus for 30 years has been Buddhist poetry of the medieval period. And he started showing me these poems when we met, and I said, I think we can do something with this. Let's make literary translations of these poems. So we did, and we still are, and it's...
How did that work at the beginning? I mean, this is something he's been doing for the... Yes. You know, all of a sudden, you're
so
there.
I had heard about translation pairs, where there's one person who's the language specialist, and then there's a poet. For instance, Stanley Kunitz translated Akhmatova, and he did not speak Russian, so he worked with a Russian mm-hmm. specialist. And so Stephen gives me what's called a trot, T-R-O-T, and it's an analysis of every word in the poem, and I work from there. And we just go back and forth until we're both happy with it.
And I'm trying to remember, I want to, before we close out, I want to make sure we get in another poem. And let's... Stephen's in this next poem, as I recall, yes?
He is.
So yes. Let's bring all these themes together. Okay. I'll tell you, we've wrapped this up nicely.
And Japan is in this, too. This is the last poem in the book. I told Jesus when I was afraid as a child, I looked for pictures of you in the encyclopedia and circled them around my bed. Jesus said, I remember Giotto, Cimabue, Fra Angelico. I remember the bells as Duccio's Maestà was carried into the cathedral. I told Jesus, I asked you to lift my gayness from me, lay down on my face in front of the altar at All Saints Church on West 4th Street in Detroit. I was 19. It was 1975, midnight, and the tiles were cold. Jesus said, I remember asking you, hath the rain a father, or who hath begotten the drops of dew? I told Jesus, for 30 years I asked you to send me someone to love, and then Stephen came and we married, but we were old, so I begged you, keep us alive, let us live a little longer. Jesus said, I remember. I remember, the poem of you that I sent to the Empress with a branch of flowering.
Patrick Donnelly, one of my favorite poets, with an incredible book. It is Little Known Operas. There is a book launch party Friday, April 5th, 7 p.m., Amherst Books. Thank you so much, Patrick. It's been an absolute pleasure to have you on the show today.
Thank you so much.